Welcome to Discovering. I'm in the Keweenaw. It's the beginning of March, and that means dog sled racing. Tonight, we'll take a look at the Copper Dog 150, and we'll tag along with UP musher Tom Bauer and his crew to find out what it takes and why they do it.
The reason why these guys are such terrific athletes isn't all genetic. A lot of it is genetic. They were born to run. But we put a lot of time into training and conditioning these dogs before they ever get to snow.
So sit back, put your feet up. It's Monday night and time for Discovering.
The secret streams that flow beneath the cliffs of colored stone. Forests thick and healthy with birch and pine and oak. Surrounded by the greatest lakes this world has ever known. Black Bear's awesome presence as he roams the hills and fields. Call of the timber wolf, the loon's lonesome trill. The eagle soaring high above, the trout lies deep and still. These are what I treasure, the only way I measure. Feelings that I have for this fine land. There is so much to discover when you're a longtime lover of northern Michigan.
It's 85 degrees in Florida. The further north you go, the further away you get from summer. In Michigan, this is as far north as you can get. We're in the Keweenaw, surrounded on three sides by Lake Superior, helping to make this the snowiest place east of the Mississippi.
We had about a week of blizzard, 50 mile an hour winds, many inches of snow, but the trails were in great shape. There was a lot of drifting on the roads, and the Road Commission in Keweenaw County did a great job clearing things up to let us bring all these people into the Keweenaw.
So far this year, 23 feet of snow and rising. To some, this may seem crazy. To those who live here, it's just winter. That much snow makes this the perfect place for skiing, snowmobiling, and dog sled racing.
We have about 139 miles race, and includes several communities, townships, villages. We get to be able to bring people together and communities together. We rely on our sponsors and be able to put on this awesome race.
For the past 5 years in March, mushers come from across the U.S. and converge in the Copper Country town of Calumet for the annual running of the Copper Dog 150 and the Copper Dog 40.
This is Copper Dog's fifth year of being in the Keweenaw. We start in Calumet, go to Eagle Harbor, come to Copper Harbor, and Sunday we're going to go back to Calumet and for a downtown finish.
Along with the mushers comes a team of handlers, a pit crew of sorts, and of course truckloads of excited, well-trained, highly fit, four-legged athletes who love their job more than anything. Tonight we'll follow the Copper Dog from start to finish. We'll also be following one of our very own, UP musher Tom Bauer, and his crew to get a feel for what it takes to put a team into the race and to maybe better understand why they do what they do, why they love the endeavor of dog sledding so much.
All right, well, we just changed plastic on our sled. We went from a medium temperature plastic to a plastic, a hard density plastic that's great for really cold weather. Tonight it's gonna get cold enough, the dog's feet are gonna probably squeak and the runners are gonna be squeaking. It's gonna be a really beautiful night with a little bit of snow. It's gonna be a fast night because it's cold. The dogs really love to kick it when it's fast.
Calumet's quite interesting because we put in the snow road, a half a mile of it, snow fence on both sides of it, a street party with fire pits, DJ, we had fireworks. We have an opportunity to let people see the businesses that support the Copper Dog so we can bring it to a downtown start like that. That's really exciting for the mushers because they get to really go down and have that adrenaline as they're starting the race.
On the gang line, leaders go out first, then the swing dogs, the team dogs, and the wheel dogs go last. And when the handlers come by, we'll get a couple of handlers to help us get them up to the line because they really want to get up there. They know it's race day. These dogs are as excited as I am. And so we're going to get them going up to the line. And we're going to be dragging on that brake all the way up there. They'll be screaming and pulling hard. And it's a really exciting feeling. Right now we're looking around. We're seeing the crowd walking around. They're getting exciting. Going out of a downtown start like this out of Calumet, there's people lining the main street all the way down, cheering us on and watching the excitement of a dog race and sharing our passion that the mushers have for dog-powered rides. And you know, we're going to be out there enjoying some of the most beautiful trails in the United States tonight by dog power all the way up to Eagle Harbor, and I'm really excited.
Hey! From Castle, Tom Bauer on the course. Hip number 10, racing from Michigan Tech and the Tamarack Inn.
Once you get past that last section of cheering crowd at the end of the main drag, and the city lights fade away behind you, and you get out there on the main trail, and it's just you and the dogs, and it's gotten dark out there, and you start to mellow out. The excitement sort of blends into a beautiful feeling of teamwork with your dogs. You might get out the poles, you might pump a little bit, you know, when they slow down, just so they know that you're back there and you're working with them and you're enjoying the beauty of the dogs in the beginning of the race. They're running hard and just looking up and seeing what the weather's like and maybe looking back and seeing who's back behind you and if that headlight's coming up behind you and looking at your lead dogs, because I got a lead dog that loves to hunt down other teams, and so when his nose goes up in the air and he starts loping hard, I know we got another team up in front of us. We'll come around a corner, sure enough, there's a headlamp, and he loves to go by. And so once you get out there, everything mellows out, and you just enjoy the beauty of the run.
There you go.
Thank you.
Hard right coming up.
Stage one of the race leaves Calumet at 7 o'clock at night and travels in the dark, goes all the way down through Lake Linden, goes into Gay, then comes back up the spine of the Keweenaw, and then travels back into Eagle Harbor on the north side of the peninsula. It's a technical part for the mushers because there's many crossings which require hundreds of volunteers, but we make it safe and we have them traverse through those communities.
The teams mush on through the night, passing through numerous road crossings, offering spectators plenty of opportunities to see the teams as they pass by on their journey. But it's really only a glimpse of the many miles of quiet, remote trails they cover by the light of a headlamp. After crossing Highway 41, the mushers split. The 150 mushers head for the end of the first stage at Eagle Harbor. And approximately 4 hours after leaving Calumet, the first of the Copper Dog 40 mushers begin to cross the Eagle River finish line.
Good dog! Ha, 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 ha! Good dog! Ha, ha!
Meanwhile, in Eagle Harbor, spectators and volunteers anxiously await the arrival of the 150 mushers. One by one, they pass through the checkpoint.
Welcome to Eagle Harbor, the end of the first leg of my race. We went out of town and hit a couple of road crossings, and one of my lead dogs decided he didn't like crossing the roads, and so we got balled up a couple of times, got out of a couple of tangles, and then we put up a different leader. Betty went up and we started loping and really had some nice runs. Got up into the hills and they slowed down a little bit. The stars came out. Right before we hit the areas that were being logged, it snowed a little bit. So like the trails were perfect along the whole way. So here we are in Eagle Harbor. We're gonna get a little bit of sleep. The dogs are all taken care of. They ate really good. They're bedded down with their blankets and their coats on. And time to go get a little bit of shut-eye.
25 mushers and a hot cup of coffee later, stage one is history. A quick night's rest for dogs and mushers, and day two begins.
Oh, yeah.
dogs take your owners for a quick morning walk. Then shine up the sleds, suit up the dogs, it's time to go. Three, two, one, and stage two is underway.
Stage two, we leave Eagle Harbor, we head all the way through the tip of the Keweenaw and come back into Copper Harbor. There's very few crossings and the mushers get to and dogs get to enjoy the beautiful Keweenaw.
Training and racing a team of sled dogs is an enormous task that would not be possible without the help of an experienced crew of handlers.
A musher can't really do it all by themselves. Because there are so many components. Now, for example, we have two trucks here today, and we have two drivers who also are mechanics. And while he's out on the trail, we're feeding the dogs from that got left behind, and we're checking feet, and we're putting straw in their boxes and coats on them. And so there are hours and hours of work behind the scenes. So there are all these other people that are involved. And they come back year after year. They just come out of the woodwork. You might not see them for months. And then they'll say, oh, you got that copper dog coming up, or the UP200, and we'll be there. And so they will follow through the night. It's like a cult almost, you know. And they'll go from checkpoint to checkpoint, and the teams will come in, and we'll catch the teams, and we're, you know, how was this corner, and how are Dagwood's feet, and you know, we want to know all that too, because we've been working with them and feeding and hooking them up along, you know, with Tom. And so there's, if he had to do all this himself, it would, you know, any of these teams would agree that you've got to have a good core group of handlers in your kennel in order to pull off a successful venture.
My dad kind of trained me to run dogs and train dogs was pretty much the same way that he taught me how to swim. When I was a little kid, he basically brought me to the deep end of the pool and picked me up and threw me in. And, you know, at first I would, you know, flail around and try to figure it out, and I'd, you know, sink inevitably, and he'd jump in and pull me out. But after a while, I became a pretty good swimmer, so it's a good way to learn things. Lessons that you'll learn dog sledding carry over into normal life, you know, every day. Working with dogs is actually like working with little kids a lot of times. I mean, they work with the same basic rules of emotion and learning. Being able to work with dogs for such a long time, whether you're a dog person or not, you learn a lot about not only the dog psyche, but the subconscious human psyche. And it's just a really interesting process. It's really interesting to see how animals react to things, how they'll learn, how they'll pick up different things slowly over time, given different teaching tactics. Even though dogs are less intelligent animals, they're very emotional, and they'll get freaked out just like us, and they'll get nervous, and they'll be happy and joyous, and they'll be totally confident. It all depends on your attitude towards them and how you train them and how you work with them.
Copper Harbor marks the end of stage two of the race. Team after team pass through the checkpoint and onto their awaiting handlers.
We have a spectator opportunity in Copper Harbor. We get to bring people here, enjoy the restaurants, the shops that are here. The mushers get to relax a little bit, take care of their dogs. Once we get here at 6 o'clock, we'll have a musher meeting. We talk about the trail and concerns that they have, and then the evening's free.
Mushers and dogs spend the rest of the day resting up for the final run to Calumet. Morning, the final day. The sun rises, the temperature drops, and the wind picks up. It's a brisk 12 below zero without the wind chill. Adverse conditions may change the strategy, but not the agenda. 43 miles away as the dog flies lies the finish line in Calumet. But to get there, mushers and their teams must first make the 600-foot climb to the top of Brockway Mountain.
Well, today we got a situation where we are going to start off out of Copper Harbor and climb Brockway Mountain. It's quite a climb. It's not a huge mountain. It's only a little over 800 feet high, but the dogs, a lot of times, like a little bit of assistance. So the trick on the beginning of this run is not to get sweated up going up Brockway Mountain, because at 12 to 20 below, going down the other side can cause a hypothermic situation. So not sweating means you've got to dress down as far as you can, but in 12 below, you can't leave any skin exposed. That's the crux today.
Hey, let's go! All right.
You can be great at school or, you know, an instrument or whatever, and you can be great at social skills and people love you and whatever, but once you step on a dog sled and you've got a gang line in half and six dogs running that way and six dogs, you know, on your team barking at you, and you've got to solve the problem, those are things that you don't plan on doing, but you kind of just have to fix, and so you do fix them, and you get better at fixing problems, and it carries over into real life. You get better at solving problems with people. You get better. I mean, a lot of mushers would argue with me. Maybe they spend too much time around dogs, but I've gotten better at dealing with at talking to people, and I've gotten better at thinking quickly. I've gotten better at just fast problem solving, and it's really helped me in everyday life. It's helped me in school. It's helped me get my priorities straight, actually, because it really gets your brain jump-started. When you really have to get out of your head, when you have to get out of that womb of selfishness, you know, thinking about all the things that you have to do and all the things that you have to accomplish in that day and all the things that you want and everything, you get out there on that sled and you are responsible for 10 to 12 dogs. You're responsible for all of their health, you're responsible for their lives, and it really takes you out of that bubble of selfishness, and it gets you thinking about responsibility and taking care of other beings, and it's a really humbling experience. It's an experience that everybody should have, I think. It's like playing on stage or doing something in front of lots of people. It's something like that where it's just, it changes the way you think about things, it changes the way you problem solve. It's a great experience, and it'll just make you a better person. You go out there on a beautiful day like this, or on a beautiful night when the moon's lighting up everything and every tree has a shadow, and it's one of the most surreal, worth it things ever. It's like standing on the edge of a mountain, or you know, watching a waterfall or something. It's worth it. You know, it's something that we can't really explain why it's worth it, but it is. And It's a really genuine experience that I suggest for everybody.
One of the things that Copper Dog's really proud of is trying to bring communities and people together. We like everything to be inclusive and try to give an opportunity. We have sponsors who are very small, a couple $100s, and we have sponsors that really come through for us. It takes all of that and all of those levels in order to make this race happen. Our volunteer base is the one thing that's complimented the most from the mushers that come over. They go to many races every year and they don't see the kind of turnout that we get and the kind of hospitality that are embraced from the people in the Keweenaw.
The race is going well. It's really fast. We're having a great trail and a lot of great competition coming in.
Congratulations on a good run, Tom Bauer.
That was a race. That was a great race. I brought a bunch of dogs here that have been doing tours for me all year. And so all weekend long I've been working to get the tour dog out of them and bring the racing dogs back. And all through the whole weekend, every leg, including today, especially today, they just shined. The racing dog came right out and they ran like heck. And And then every once in a while they'd slow down and they'd need to take a union break. So we had a great time out there. The trails are beautiful. Running dogs in the Copper Country is the best. I can't see myself ever totally getting out of it. There's a fair amount of hardship to having a large kennel, and there's a commitment that you make and your family makes to be able to to be able to enjoy this sport, and to be able to enjoy the passion of running dogs. But I think probably until I'm, you know, that little 80-year-old guy still trying to chop my firewood by myself, I'll have a small kennel of dogs and we'll be hooking up and going out whenever we can. It's hard to describe, but when I was dragged down to that chicken coop on the back of a sled by three dogs that had never done it before, I'm looking at this, I'm going, wow, how come it took me so long to discover this? This is just really, really cool. And when you can take puppies and turn them into dogs' companions that you can go out and travel with, miles and miles and miles through beautiful country like this, it's amazing. It's my passion. I love it. I just love it. There's no other way to describe it. I'll never get out of it. It's an addiction.
A silent night, the only light creating shadows from the moon's glow. The only sounds, the patter of feet and the runners on the snow. It's all for one and one for all, a bond beyond compare. The dogs, the musher, and a friendship together only they can share. They lead by example, by pushing on through conditions no matter how adverse. They teach about life and truth and friendship without ever speaking a verse. They suggest it's not important whether you succeed or fail, but that the true success is measured by the time spent on the trail. They are heroes and leaders, one and all. For that they seem to have been bred. I speak not only of the pullers, but the musher who rides the sled.